throughout the week. It is truly a blessing that there are so many ways to be connected to the body of Christ, even when we're not able to be physically all together. So we give thanks for everyone who is here with us at this moment or in the future, and we lift up our announcements and our ministries, hoping that they are encouraging for all, and I hope even if you're not in the sanctuary today, you know that you are welcome to join us in any of these events if you would choose. You see the choir schedule is listed in your bulletin. Upcoming events, we have a Green Team meeting, a PW meeting. I know they are having special treats this Wednesday, so they would really appreciate knowing a little bit closer to an exact count of how many will be there. Darlene, you want to raise your hand? Let Darlene know if you plan to be there today. The 15th, we will have our session meeting, and we are getting ever closer to our blood drive, the 28th. So if you signed up either to give blood or to be a volunteer, please keep that date in your mind as well. The food pantry, we continue to collect size 4 and 5 diapers, baby wipes, and canned fruit. Those are the items that we have received from them that they are in special need of. And so we thank everybody who brings them in and puts them in our big burlap box. Again, we are looking for liturgists. I'm getting bolder about asking, but if you'd like to volunteer, please let me know and I will sign you up. And then the annual meeting will be held today after worship. It's why you have all the papers in front of you. It's a great chance to celebrate the past year and pray for the coming year. Everybody is welcome to be in attendance of the annual meeting. And if you are an active member, you are welcome to vote. But we encourage everyone to be informed and involved and prayerfully excited about the year to come. Are there any other announcements that I have forgotten? Then let us continue in worship together.
Thank you. It's so wonderful to have you guys singing again. Please join me in the call to worship. Those who love Jesus, keep his words.
Those who love Christ will make their home with God.
Those who know Jesus will know his peace.
Those who know Jesus will be taught in the ways of peace.
Come follow and love Jesus our Lord, who has come to be among us.
Come worship God, who lives among us, loves us, and calls us home.
Amen.
Amen.
Prayer of confession. God is the witness in our lives, the one who sees all we do and fail to do, the one who hears what we say and don't. God is also the one who cleanses us, who makes us pure, who forgives us. Join me as we pray to our God. Eternal God,
do not change. You have revealed yourself to us in your word and given us the Holy Spirit. You call us to worship you in spirit and in truth. Forgive us when our worship shapes you into what we want instead of shaping us into what you want. Help us to meet you here that we might bow before your great majesty and holiness. And so live for you now and ever. In Christ our Lord, through the power of the Holy Spirit.
Assurance of pardon. Renewed and made whole, we see the path God has prepared for us. The way of peace, the way of hope, the way of grace, the way of service. In Jesus Christ, we are forgiven. Thanks be to God. Amen.
Thank you.
Our scripture reading this morning comes from the Gospel of John, beginning in chapter 14, verse 25. Let us listen to the word of God. I have said these things to you while I am still with you, but the Advocate, the Holy Spirit, whom the Father will send in my name, will teach you everything and remind you of all that I have said to you. Peace I leave with you. My peace I give to you. I do not give to you as the world gives. Do not let your hearts be troubled, and do not let them be afraid. May God bless this reading to our understanding. So over the last month or so, hide and seek has become a favorite game at our house. At least once a day, a child or two runs through the living room and says, "Shh, I'm hiding," and then tries to fit into a laundry basket or a cupboard or something. And I hear the counting, one, two, three, and then what do you say next? Ready or not, here I come. And the search is on. The funny thing is, the search never takes long. Because whenever the big boys get near Gus, who's four, I hear this, ha. It's loud enough to be quite directional. Gus is so excited to be found, he just can't hold in his joy. It's adorable. He doesn't win very often, but it's adorable. And I think it's a perfect metaphor for our learning for today. Today, we are going to learn about what Presbyterians believe about the Holy Spirit. And I think one of the reasons that this is so important is because of what we learned in our hide-and-seek story. We, as humans, we don't prefer to be alone for long periods of time. We don't like to feel hidden or put aside. And so when someone is close to finding us, to accompanying us, to paying attention to us, we giggle with a joy that overflows. When Jesus is talking with his disciples before his death, he said that he would send the Holy Spirit to be with them, so they would never, ever be alone. The Holy Spirit would be his presence with them. Friends, the Holy Spirit finds us wherever we are, even if we are hiding. And the Spirit walks with us and nudges us and teaches us, and this alone should bring incredible delight into our hearts. Thomas Lindbergh takes up this topic in one of his devotions, and I want to read just a little bit to you to talk about the work of the Spirit and how he understood it to be. He wrote about the great Norwegian explorer Roald Amundsen. He was the first to discover the magnetic meridian of the North Pole and to discover the South Pole. And on one of his trips, Amundsen took a homing pigeon with him. And when he had finally reached the peak that he was climbing, he opened the bird's confinement and set it free. Imagine the delight of Amundsen's wife all the way back in Norway when she looked up from the doorway of her home and she saw the pigeon circling around. And she knew that her husband was okay, that he was alive. Thomas Lindbergh says, so it was when Jesus ascended. He was gone from sight, but the disciples clung to his promise to send them a sign, to send them the Holy Spirit. What joy then when the dove-like Holy Spirit descended at Pentecost. The disciples had with them the continual reminder that Jesus was alive and victorious and seated at the right hand of God. This continues to be the Spirit's message to each of us. Now, I think as Presbyterians, sometimes nicknamed the Frozen Chosen, right? We don't talk a lot about the Spirit in church. Maybe I think it's because it's a little bit like talking about air. It's everywhere, right? It makes everything possible. But since we can't see it, and since it's a part of every moment, and we kind of know that intellectually, we take for granted that it's there and it's working. The Holy Spirit is everywhere. It makes everything possible. And so I want us to be careful not to take for granted that the Spirit is there and the Spirit is working. When I teach confirmation classes, I often ask the students as one of their final projects to pick 3 everyday items to bring to class that remind them of God and Jesus and the Holy Spirit. And it's one of my favorite moments of confirmation to see what the students bring. And one year, one of our guys brought a duck decoy to represent the Holy Spirit. And he said to me, you know, duck decoys, they float in the water calmly, and they show him where to look and where to pay attention. And the decoy hopefully attracts other good things to it. For him, this was how the Holy Spirit worked. Isn't that fabulous? I wonder if I were to ask you, and I won't, to bring an object to church that described your understanding of the Holy Spirit, what might you bring? What would you say the Spirit has done for you? When have you noticed yourself in her presence? Our scripture reading today reminds us that the Holy Spirit works in very specific ways. First of all, the Spirit makes Scripture come alive for us. John says that the Spirit constantly reminds us of everything that Jesus taught. When we read Scripture, the Holy Spirit makes those ancient words apply to us. Have you ever opened up your Bible and just sort of put your thumb down? And they were exactly the words you needed at that moment? Or have you ever been in church and you've listened to a Bible reading you've heard hundreds of times and all of a sudden you heard something new, something exciting, something that seemed like it was a message just for you? That is the Holy Spirit at work. Another way the Holy Spirit works in our lives, according to Presbyterian beliefs, is to make the sacraments come alive for us. When we come to the table, the Spirit helps us experience the presence of Jesus in the bread and the cup. Likewise, during a baptism, the Spirit joins us to God and to one another. The Spirit is at work in our lives and in our worship, connecting us to the triune God and enlivening every moment of our human experience. So then it's no surprise that the third point is that the Spirit makes faith come alive for us. Through the work of the Spirit in our lives, our faith becomes more than just a code of ethics. We are given new life and new purpose. And the Spirit gives us gifts that help us to fulfill our purpose. In 1 Corinthians, Scripture teaches that some of the gifts of the Spirit are wisdom, knowledge, faith, power to do miracles, the power to prophecy, the discerning of spirits, and the ability to speak and to understand different tongues. I wonder if you have a sense of what some of the gifts of the Spirit are for you. What is it that you do well? That you do easily? That you enjoy doing? That's actually a gift of the Spirit. Our Presbyterian Study Catechism sums up the work of the Spirit in two questions and answers. In question 43, it asks, "What do you believe when you confess your faith in the Holy Spirit?" And the answer reads, "The Holy Spirit is the divine person who enables us to love and to know and to serve Jesus Christ." The following question continues, how do we receive the Holy Spirit? And the answer is by receiving the Word of God. The Spirit arrives with the Word, brings us new life, and assures us of eternal life. The Spirit nurtures, corrects, and strengthens us with the truth of the Word of God. What an amazing relationship that we need to cultivate with the one who nurtures and corrects and strengthens us with the Word of God. The work of the Holy Spirit is vital in our life. Sometimes, without even realizing it, the Spirit illuminates truth for us, communicates God's will for us, nudges us, or sometimes kind of pushes us, right? Ever had one of those moments? In the right direction. The Spirit helps us understand our calling, helps us live as vibrant and energetic people. The Spirit gives us connection with God and with one another. A story is told of a famous preacher who stood in front of his congregation with a big jar filled with rocks. And he said, "How can I get the last of the air out of this jar?" And the first person raised their hand and they said, "Well, you just create a vacuum. It'll suck all the air out." And he said, "Yes, but the force of the vacuum created will cause the glass to break." And so a couple more people offered what turned out to be incorrect ideas. And the preacher picked up a pitcher of water and poured it into the jar. And all the air was gone. The lesson was that to live a full Christian life does not mean to suck out sin here and there, but rather to be so full of the Holy Spirit that there's no room for the negative to be in your life anymore. What a great image, to be so full of the Holy Spirit that there's no room for sin, no room for negativity, for cynicism, for anything that you find unpleasant inside of you. What if you invited the Holy Spirit to fill up your heart and your mind, to focus your thoughts on understanding the Word of God, to experience the joy of improving and living out the gifts that God has already given you? What if you invited the Holy Spirit to fill you with such joy and such hope and such vibrancy, there was no room for anything else? It's a good goal, right? Guess what? It takes a lot of practice. And we fail often. But it's our goal, and it's important to keep after it. Now we know, when we talk about the Holy Spirit, right, this big, vibrant person of the Trinity, it would be silly for me to say, and the Holy Spirit only lives in the sanctuary, right? That would be ridiculous. Who would think like that? Except sometimes I think, we sort of think the Holy Spirit works in here. And so I want to conclude by affirming for us, the Holy Spirit is hard at work outside of these walls in some amazing and vibrant and inspiring ways. And so as we conclude our sermon today and we turn to our video about our 1001 Presbyterian worshiping community, this video is about a community that is finding a new way for people to connect with the Holy Spirit outside of church walls. A new way that this preacher is able to offer the gifts of the Spirit to those who are at home or in their car or anyways through his Christian podcast. So as we watch the video about the new ways that Presbyterians are finding to invite the Spirit into the world, I hope you think about how God is calling you to fill yourself with good so much that you can't help but radiate that goodness to everyone around you outside of these walls. Amen.
It started out actually as a church plant. I had a sense of call to work with artists and to bring them together. The community piece is interesting because a lot of the work I've done is kind of one-on-one or in small groups. And then putting it out online as a podcast, the audience has grown like crazy. We're up to like 1,200 listeners a day to the podcast. I've never preached for an audience that big in all the years I've been in church. Not on a daily basis, that's insane. And what I've discovered is even for artists who are secular, they connect with that idea of something bigger than themselves. I have followed the lead of God. I have followed the nudging of the Spirit. People are already listening to podcasts. And so if we really are embodying the Spirit, if we are embodying Christ's very self, we should be in those places too. I've been convicted to explore the world as I know it as a person of faith, tethered to the church, and free to explore where the Spirit is at work in the world. I think that's the work of the church. I think we have lost sight of that, but I think that's the work of the church, is to find where God is already at work in the world. There's a young woman in North Carolina who came to one of our live events in Atlanta, and she said, "I want to tell you that your podcast is a lifeline for me." That was a conviction straight from God. I cling to that conversation all the time because it just reminds me why we're doing what we do. Because there really is a deep hunger that the church, for all of its good that it does in the world, is not meeting this particular hunger. And so we are finding a way to do that, and we are part of the PCUSA doing that.
It's a good question for us about how we meet the deep hunger of the world. Sometimes we forget, just because not everybody in the world is in here, doesn't mean that they're not searching after what we find here. How do we, who are fed at this table, offer that nourishment to the rest of the world?
because we know, friends, that we come as guests invited. Jesus said that we would come from north and south, from east and west, to sit at table together, and everyone is welcome at Jesus' table. Let's bow our heads in prayer. Gracious God, creator and ruler of the universe, we give you thanks that in the beginning of time you created all things and you called them good. We also acknowledge that from the beginning of time we did not listen to your will or your way, but we turned aside to chase after our own desires. We thank you that you have never given up on us, and you have never stopped loving us. You sent prophets and priests, judges and kings to call us back to your way. And in the fullness of time, when even these were not enough, you sent your only Son, our Lord, that by his life we might learn how to live, and by his death we might have open to us the gates of eternal life. Send your Holy Spirit upon us this morning, we pray, and upon all of our gifts of bread and juice. May the bread that we break and the cup that we bless be the body and blood of Christ for us. By the power of the Holy Spirit, may it unite us with the faithful of every time and place, until we are at last gathered together at your heavenly banquet table. All this we pray in the name of the Father and the Son and the Holy Spirit, three in one, now and always. Amen. Friends, we remember that on the night when Jesus was betrayed, he sat at table with his disciples. And after having given thanks to God, he took the bread and broke it, saying, "This is my body, broken for you. Whenever you eat of it, remember me. I invite you to partake of your bread now." After the meal, he took the cup of the covenant, and he said, "This is the cup of the covenant, poured out for you, poured out in my blood, poured out for the forgiveness of your sin. Whenever you drink of it, remember me." I invite you to partake of your cup now. Friends, whenever we eat this bread and drink from this cup, we do indeed remember Christ's life and death and resurrection until he comes again. Let us bow our heads in gratitude for the meal that we have received. Gracious God, we thank you for inviting us here and meeting us here and feeding us here. We thank you for this bite of bread and drip of juice that is transformed for us by the power of the Holy Spirit to nourish not only our bodies, but also our eternal spirits. We ask that we who have seen you broken and poured out here, might seek to be your light, poured out in a world that is too often broken. May we bring healing and hope in the power of your name. Amen. Friends, let us stand and sing our final hymn.